वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। हरि ओम तत्सत। लास्ट संडे वी स्टडीड द लास्ट फ्यू वर्सेस ऑफ द थर्ड चैप्टर डीलिंग विथ अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट थीम। हाउ डज अ ह्यूमन बीइंग कमिट क्राइम? व्हाट इज इट्स ऑरिजिन? हाउ कैन वी save a human being from committing crime or evil? That was a very great discussion, and Krishna's wisdom was so expressed in those few verses. Today we enter into the fourth chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. And this chapter begins with a wonderful statement. The philosophy that has been expounded in chapters 2 and 3 is called yoga in this very fourth chapter. This is something original given by Bhagavan Sri Krishna. This yoga is not like other type of yogas which are specialized spiritual practices like Patanjali yoga. This is a yoga of work, as we studied in the second and third chapters. A human being at work. A philosophy is given to that human being to make him or her work more efficiently, more productively, and in while so doing, to become purer, nobler, qualitatively richer within oneself. That is the content of the yoga that Krishna expounded as an original philosophy of life in the second and third chapters. That is referred to at the beginning of this fourth chapter. Sri Bhagavan Uvacha. Sri Bhagavan said, Imam Vivasvate Yogam Proktavan Aham Avyayam Vivasvan Manave Praha Madurakshagave Abravid एवं परंपरा प्राप्तमिमं राजर्षयो विदुः सकाले नेहं हता योगो नष्टः परंतप। इन टू वर्सेस कृष्णा स्पीक्स ऑफ दिस योगा कमिंग फ्रॉम एंशिएंट टाइम्स इन अ सक्सेशन ऑफ टीचर स्टूडेंट रिलेशनशिप। ही सेज I taught this yoga to Vivasvan, that is the sun, the god of the sun. In the Vedic language we call Vivasvan. Then Avyayam, this imperishable truth of yoga, I taught it to that great center of power at the time, Vivasvan. Vivasvan taught it to Manu. Vivasvan Manave Praha. Manu is considered to be the mythical ancestor of all human beings. From him have come humanity. So humanity is called in Sanskrit Manava, Manushya, coming from Manu. So Manu got it from his teacher, Vivasvan. Manu Ikshvakave Abravit. Manu taught it to Ikshvaku, who is the great king in the Solar dynasty, Purivamsha, in which dynasty also came Sri Rama later on. Now these are the three characters mentioned here to whom Krishna taught this yoga. Then what happened? The next shloka says, this yoga coming from teacher to student in a parampara, guru, shishya, parampara means succession. All these rajarshis knew this great philosophy. Evam parampara praptam imam. Rajarshiyo viduhu. The rajarshis knew this philosophy. They lived this philosophy. They worked in society, handled their power in society based upon this philosophy. But the last line says, Sakale neha mahata yogo nashta parantapa. In course of time, long time, this yoga became slowly diluted and diluted. Ultimately, it was lost in society. That's the language. A great succession. People handling power, authority, using that power for the good of all. Thus, we had this philosophy operating in society for the good of all for ages. But in course of time, as happens to everything in this world, things become diluted, finally they get lost. That's what he said. Yogo nashta parantapa. This yoga became lost, O Arjuna. How was it lost? This subject is taken up by Shankaracharya in his very beautiful commentary. How does a great teaching get weakened and gets lost? And he gives the answer. Durbalan ajitendriyan prapya yogo nashta parantapa. This yoga was lost when it fell into the hands of durbalan, weak people, physically, mentally weak people. They dilute a great philosophy because they don't have the strength within. So durbalan. Second is ajitendriyan. Those who have no self-discipline, the entire sensory system needs to be disciplined to develop high character. Then only we can touch the divine that is within. That kind of discipline, those people did not have. They are called ajita indriyan. Indriyas means the sensory system. Jita means conquest. Ajita indriya means non-conquest of the sensory system. We just go as the senses drag us on. How can high character appear where there is no self-discipline, self-control of the psycho-physical energies in the system? The human brain was developed in evolution to be able to guide and control the entire psycho-physical energy system. That brain did not function in its own way. It became a slave to the sensory system. In such a situation, we go down and down in life. We become petty, we become small, we become violent. What all evils you see in society are the fruits of this want of self-discipline in every individual. Therefore, the shloka said, this yoga was lost in society, but it was known to Rajarshis. A very significant word has been added here. Rajarshiyo viduhu. Rajarshis knew this yoga. They practiced it. They lived it. What is the meaning of this great word? Rajarshi. It is a combination of two words. Raja and Rishi. Raja actually means a king or a crowned head. But today there are no crowned heads. So it actually means holders of power. A president of the United States is not a crowned head, but he is a Raja from this point of view. He holds power. So also in many situations, crowned head is not needed to indicate a Raja. Raja is one who shines in the power that he represents. That's called Raja. It is one thing to have power, but the main question is, how is that power used? Does it make for happiness and welfare of people? Does it make for life fulfillment of the people? The subject of power is very important for all societies. Wherever people gather together, live together, power comes. How to organize human life? Political power is the most prominent power in society. Wherever there is a polity, there is power. To regulate affairs of the individuals constituting that polity. And so, power is a fact. Political power has got an overwhelming influence on all other types of power. There is money power. There is intellectual power. There is church or other religious power. All these powers are there, but the political power overarches all this power. We have a great discussion on this subject of power in the Mahabharata. And there, power used for the good of all is due to some development within the holder of power. That development is what is called yoga here. If that person is a yogi, he will use that power for the good of all. That person has achieved a little spiritual growth, has manifested the divine that is within him or her, even a little. Therefore, that second word is used here. Rishi means sage. Not only he has power, not only he or she is a Raja or Rani, but he or she uses that power for the good of others, for the service of others. That makes that person spiritually grown. That spiritual development has taken place. That is indicated by the word Rishi. Rishi in Sanskrit means a sage. The Rishis of the Upanishads, we say, sages of the Upanishads. So Rishi, without any mystery or magical meaning, means one who has grown spiritually, who is not caught up in this organic system, who is not confined to this organic system, who has gone beyond the limitations of this organic system by manifesting the divine spark that is present in that person. Now, this is what makes for Rishihood. According to Indian tradition, this is the privilege of every human being. Spirituality, spiritual growth and development is the privilege of every human being. We have the organic capacity to manifest that divine that is within us. That is called spirituality. It has nothing to do with a creed or a dogma. Even an agnostic may be more spiritual than many people who believe in some god or some other power. But Vedanta, India's philosophy, says this is the prerogative of every human being. Nature has given all of us that capacity to evolve beyond the organic system. Up to the organic system, nature has done the evolution. Now we are asked to do the evolution ourselves. That second evolution is what makes for yoga, what is inspired by this Krishna's philosophy of yoga. We discipline all these sensory energies within us, and we give these energies a higher direction, make it expansive. That is a beautiful concept, because, as we call it in Sanskrit, the human being can expand, not only a little physical expansion by physical growth, not only a little intellectual expansion through mental development of knowledge, but the most primary expansion, which takes evolution to higher levels, is spiritual expansion. We grow beyond our own organic limitation. Then we can give our love to others, take care of others, serve others, the capacity, feeling, oneness with others, all this will come along with this spiritual growth. And so, the word Rishi represents this spiritual growth to a large extent. So when you combine power and this kind of spiritual growth, then something great happens. Happiness and welfare become scattered all over society. When power is handled like this, that power has tremendous capacity to make for general happiness and welfare. Two great values are included here and beautifully blended. One is political and other power. Second is orientation towards love and concern for others and service of others. These are two combined together in the same person. That same person is called Rajarshi. Rajanascha Te Rishayascha Rajarshihi. One who is a Raja and a Rishi in one, says Shankaracharya in his commentary on this verse. That is a wonderful idea. In the Mahabharata, their great epic, we have one whole section called Shanti Parva, in which Bhishma, the great general of the Pandava army, of the Kaurava army, lying on his bed of arrows, gives instruction to the Pandavas and to Krishna and to others. There is a very famous passage in the Mahabharata. Three subjects are discussed by Bhishma there. One is called Rajadharma, the ethics of the state. Politics is the fullest sense of the term. That is the first subject that Bhishma discusses there. The second subject is Apadharma. Whenever a political state is in a difficult situation, how to meet that difficult situation? An individual or a group or the political state. All may pass through difficult situations. Apat means a difficult situation, dangerous situation. How to face those difficult situations? That's called Apat Dharma. And finally comes Moksha Dharma. How to get freedom, spiritual freedom, freedom from all bondages. That is the greatest ideal of human life according to Indian philosophy. Moksha is the highest purushartha, dharma, artha, kama. These are our normal purusharthas when we live in society. But moksha represents the highest transcendental development of man. True freedom, spiritual, and fully realized here and now in this very body. That's called moksha. So moksha dharma forms the third dharma expounded by Bhishma in the Mahabharata Shanti Parva. There, dealing with Raja Dharma, Bhishma says all dharmas are included in Raja Dharma. Like the footprint of an elephant can contain the footprints of all other animals, so in Raja Dharma, all dharmas are included. Sarve Dharma Raja Dharma Pradishtha. Everyone, every dharma is there in Raja Dharma. The state is healthy, other aspects of life become healthy. The state is unhealthy, everything goes wrong. So the importance of the state, political state, is emphasized by Bhishma, and we all understand it today. Chaotic conditions come when there is no political state. That is why the state has come into existence. And in this state, there is always the problem of power. That is a very important problem. Whenever you live together in a community, the problem of power comes. We want somebody to look after the affairs of the state. We give that person a little power. He may increase it, he may misuse it, he may do anything. But that is a great problem. So that we have had monarchies, we had dictatorships, we had plutocracies, we had all sorts of governments in the past. And now there is democracy, people's power. Yes, power is scattered in millions of people. In name, Even in democracy, actually, the power belongs to just a handful of people. They exercise power over the rest of the population. So, excess power in a few means lesser power in the many. This is a fact of human life. You can see in any society, take India today, a simple clerk in an office or a constable on the road has more power than any citizen. Therefore, we have to discuss the nature of power and how to tame power. We have not done it in India in the post-independence period. Bhishma did it long ago. A few others also have done it in the past. But in the West, we had so many writers who have written on the subject of power. Particularly, I wish to refer to our great agnostic intellectual, Bertrand Russell, the British intellectual. He has discussed the subject of power in a book. Its name is Power, A New Social Analysis, originally published in 1938, but an unwinned edition came in 1975. In this, he discusses various aspects of this subject of power. And towards the end, there are two chapters. One is called, last two chapters, Ethics of Power and the Taming of Power. They are very interesting chapters for us. We also need to discuss this subject much more hereafter. Here is that section dealing with ethics of power in this book. The Great War, I am quoting his words, The Great War and its aftermath of dictatorships has caused many to underestimate all forms of power except military and governmental force. This is a short-sighted and unhistorical view. If I had to select four men who have had more power than any others, I should mention Buddha and Christ, Pythagoras and Galileo, two spiritual powers, two scientific powers he has mentioned. No one of these four had to support the state until after his propaganda had achieved a great measure of success. No one of the four had much success in his own lifetime. No one of the four would have affected human life as he has done if power had been his primary object. See the wonderful expression. If they had only thought of power, they would not have affected people so well, because they didn't think of power. They thought of doing great things, and that turned out as power later on. Therefore, he says, no one of the four thought the kind of power that enslaves others, but the kind that sets them free. In the case of the first two, by showing how to master the desires that lead to strife and thence to defeat slavery and subjection. That is the contribution of Buddha and Christ. Then, he says, then to defeat slavery and subjection. In the case of the second two, the two scientists mentioned, Pythagoras as well as Galileo, he says, by showing how to the case, pointing the way towards control of natural forces through scientific discipline. It is not ultimately by violence that men are ruled, but by the wisdom of those who appeal to the common desires of mankind for happiness, for inward and outward peace, and for the understanding of the world in which, by no choice of our own, we have to live. And so the taming of power, the ethics of power, discussed by Bertrand Russell, tells us that the power of spirituality has been supreme for ages and ages. But today we use religion, the word spirituality has no meaning there. Mere doctrine, dogma, also centers of power, of violence, of crime, of war, all coming from religion understood in that non-spiritual way. But finally, when you understand religion correctly, this very agnostic thinker, who is considered to be the enemy of our religion, appreciates the spiritual quality of religion. He says, in the last particular point, the taming of power, in that section, he says, yes, there has been in the past one of the purposes of religion, namely to give value to human life. The churches, however, have also had other purposes, and their dogmatic basis causes difficulties. For those to whom traditional religion is no longer possible, there are other ways. And so, finally, he says, what is of most value in human life is more analogous to what all the great religious teachers have spoken of. They gave us the power to restrain ourselves. Then we become a force for positive good. Therefore, in that situation, you can have power without destroying the freedom of others. Otherwise, power must destroy the freedom of others. In this kind of discussion, therefore, you find this subject coming up, that in society, different groups of people have different quantum of power. A father has power over children, a teacher has power over students, and students also have power over teachers, especially in the modern context. So also intellectual power. Scientists have power to control the people and society around. Political power, administrative power is the most important. How shall we modify and tame this power to make it worthy of serving the people? In democracy, there is a greater possibility of making this freedom of humanity a permanent feature, provided in that democracy we are able to tame power by the spiritual motivation. The only motivation by which we can tame power is the spiritual motivation. That spiritual motivation comes from the spiritual growth of the individual concerned. That spiritual growth is assured when we know that we have a divine spark hidden within ourselves. When we are able to stir that dimension, all these positive virtues come out of us. Love, compassion, the spirit of service. What can I do for you? I have power. I want to use it for making you happy. This kind of attitude comes through spiritual growth. That is why Sri Krishna wants us to combine these two values. One is political power, the other is spiritual power or spiritual growth. When these are combined, power becomes conducive to the protection of liberty of people and to make them happier and better. Anybody, whether it is the Prime Minister, the collector of a district, or a panchayat chief, every one of them has power over the rest of the people. But that power has been chastened by the little spiritual growth, character efficiency coming into the picture, manifestation of the divine that is within. Even a little, it's not to become saints. That is a very high subject. Here we are dealing with average human beings living in society, interacting with each other. How shall he or she interact in the happiest way possible? That can happen only if there is a slight spiritual growth in the individual's concern. Out of that comes character. Out of that comes concern for others. This is human evolution. Organic evolution has no meaning for a being like man, who has been endowed by nature by the most versatile organ, the cerebral system, with the help of which He or she can invent any organs or instruments he or she likes. So we have to seek evolution at a higher level. That is 20th century biology's dictum. That higher level is referred to by Sir Julian Huxley, the famous British biologist, as psychosocial evolution. This psyche must be able to detach itself from this tiny organic system and expand in love and concern for other organic systems. Then you are on the road to psychosocial evolution. The goal of that psychosocial evolution is fulfillment, according to 20th century biology. Fulfillment of oneself, fulfillment of others as well. In this way, beautiful ideas are coming from science itself today as to the nature of human life and human destiny. Our destiny is to make possible a happy and fulfilled life to all humanity. That is the direction of our evolution. We have to intensify it by introducing these changes within oneself. All ethical, moral, spiritual teachings are meant to release the spiritual forces that are within us, by which we develop compassion. We go beyond our own self-interest to take in the interest of other people. Wherever power is in the hands of one whose interests are more than self, that power becomes positive and creative. That comes from individual growth, individual development, development beyond the physical level, beyond the intellectual level. We call it therefore spiritual, because it is not a mere organic development, something more than organic. The true nature of human being finds manifestation there. Much of human being is nothing but physical nature. That physical nature controls us. That makes us selfish, even aggressive. But because there is a human nature over and above physical nature within a human being, in that human nature you find a spark of divinity. Its manifestation makes for all these great developments in human life. Man really evolves in that state only. This is human evolution. We call it the spiritual growth of the human being. It is the prerogative of every human being to take his or her life in the hand and give it a shape, give it a direction. The human brain can conceive of that direction and take life also in that direction. That is the Vedantic dictum. Human beings have this capacity. This is why Gita is expounding this great philosophy of yoga. The entire evolutionary march of the human being from creatureliness to freedom, from creatureliness to blessedness, that subject is called yoga. It is meant for all. It has nothing to do with any particular religion or a particular creed or a particular nation. It is just human development in the fullest sense of the term. So in these two shlokas of the fourth chapter, we have these great ideas. This concept of Rajarshi is a great concept. Rajanascha Rishayascha Te Rajarshihi. When you combine power with spirituality and spiritual strength, you become a Rajarshi. You become a blessing to humanity. Power is really a blessing in that situation. We cannot escape exercising power. As I said, in a society, there is always a center of power here, a center of power there. So power is bound to be there. But how to use it is a great question. How to make it subserve the interest of all is a great question. That question is taken up by Krishna in this wonderful teaching by saying, add a little spiritual touch to the power that you have. And that spiritual touch doesn't come from believing in a creed or a dogma, but your own spiritual growth. Beyond your organic growth, you have a spiritual growth. There are spiritual energy resources hidden within you. When this growth takes place, You handle power in the best manner possible. In a democracy, when thousands of people holding power develop this little spiritual growth, then that democracy will be a stable democracy, where people's freedom and liberty will be fully protected and their life will be in the direction of fulfillment. This concept of Rajarshi, I am glad to find, upheld by great Chinese thinkers. There in China they call it sagely within, kingly without. That's a beautiful expression. Taoist philosopher and Confucian philosopher, they speak of it. Inwardly, you are a sage. Outwardly, you are a king. You hold power. So sagely within, kingly without is exactly what Krishna means here, Rajarshi. There is nothing utopian about it. In this modern age, there are no impossibles. Most impossibles have become possibles today, including landing on the moon or a voyager going beyond the solar system. So that in man's life, in human life, there is nothing impossible. We have the capacity to control our emotions, to control our impulses, to make for a stable, steady character. A little achievement of this makes for an ordered social life. A little more makes for handling power for the good of all. Therefore, we have to take into account these great possibilities hidden in every human being. That is the science of human possibilities. In fact, I am using this term, science of human possibilities, coined by same Sir Julian Huxley. He said, we have discovered many sciences today dealing with physical nature, but we want a new science today, and he called it the science of human possibilities. What Sri Krishna is telling in this great book of the Gita as yoga is essentially that science of human possibilities. Like any science, you can check it, verify it, you can question it. In fact, the more you question, the more you will get it. A few verses later, in this very chapter, you will get this instruction. Understand this subject through questioning, continuous questioning. Pariprasnena sevaya. You will be studying that verse after about 26th or 27th of this verse here. Pariprasna, question. Truth shines better through questioning, through investigation. Like gold, it shines better when it is put into fire. That is how Krishna expounded this wonderful science of human possibilities. In this very life, we can conquer this relativity and become free. Ihaiva tadjita sargo. In the 5th chapter you will read in the Gita. Ihaiva, in this very life, in this very body, we have the capacity to overcome all these things that make us unfree, that make us creaturely, and put us on the pedestal of freedom. You can achieve it here and now. Now that is the supreme contribution of Bhagavan Sri Krishna in the Gita, such a great epic, the Mahabharata, 100,000 verses, in which this Gita is considered to be the most essence of the whole Mahabharata. And that is why it has become universal in scope today, spreading all over. It has intense practical application. Unlike religious books, Gita doesn't deal with man at prayer, man at worship, man doing ritual, or man doing meditation. It deals with man at work, working people in various departments of life. During that work, can he or she become spiritual? Can he or she become a friend of all? He or she can. Krishna whispers this profound philosophy to all. Towards the end of the next few chapters, you will find the last utterance Krishna says, Tasmat yogi bhava arjuna. Arjuna, be a yogi. Be a yogi in this sense. Be a full human being. Manifest all your possibilities within. What a beautiful message it is for humanity everywhere. And so, these two verses of the fourth chapter are profound in significance. We had the idea that these books were meant to be recited and to get peace of mind. We never understood its practical value. It was Swami Vivekananda in our time that brought this idea before us, that the Gita is the greatest book of practical Vedanta. How to make Vedanta practical? The philosophy of the Upanishads, such a lofty philosophy. How to make it practical? It speaks of man as essentially divine, and it speaks about oneness with all. We are all essentially one. Now these are all beautiful ideas. How to make it practical? In order to achieve it, Krishna expounded this great Bhagavad Gita ages ago. It is unknown. Shankaracharya brought it out from the epic by writing his own beautiful commentary. Since then, it has become more and more popular. But in the modern period, it has crossed all bounds of nation or creed. It has gone around the world today. And I am sure we can develop a new type of humanity worthy of the tremendous technological developments that we find all around us, uniting the whole world physically. And the Gita will add the counterpart from within, uniting the whole world mentally and spiritually. That is the importance of this chapter, of the fourth chapter, dealing with the succession of yoga, ancient times to modern times, and it became lost. And now, in the third verse, Krishna is telling Arjuna, Taevayam, Taevayam mayatedya yoga prokta puratanaha bhaktosi me sakacheti rahasyam hetad uttamam. Arjuna, today I have told you that same yoga which I had told earlier to all those great royal sages. Because you are my devotee, not only devotee, you are my friend. Bhaktosi me sakacheti. You are my devotee, you are my friend. So I wanted to convey to you a profound truth. I have conveyed it to you in the two chapters, second and third. Sa evayam mayatedya. This is yoga prokta puratanaha. This ancient yoga. Bhaktosi me sakacheti. Rahasyam hetad uttamam. Rahasyam. A profound truth. Not secret. Not private, but profound, and uttamam, supremely profound. Just imagine, take all the sciences, physics, chemistry, botany, zoology, astronomy, or many other sciences we have recently developed. They are all sciences. And here is the science of human possibilities, the yoga. You will find all of the sciences are helpful to us. We do derive blessing from them. But this science gives you the maximum blessing, complete fulfillment of life. It is like watering the leaves and twigs of a tree. Whereas in this science, we get watering the root of a tree. Human life is watered from the root. That's the nature of yoga. That's why it is called the science of human possibilities. Science of nature's possibilities we study in physical sciences. That gives us wealth, pleasure, gadgets, very, very many good things we get. But human beings' fulfillment doesn't depend upon all those things only. They can also make for unfulfillment, like Goethe's Faust. Ah, I know our unfulfillment now. That's the language he has used there in that famous drama. Because you lit a fire in my heart, which is now burning me. From desire, I stumbled to possession, and in possession I stumbled, I languish in desire. That's the language. Soliloquy of Faust in the woods. So this kind of tragedy will come to us if only we depend upon all the so-called positivistic sciences. We do need them, but only as a servant to satisfy our creature comforts. But our higher development of life can come only from the science of human possibilities, which is the yoga taught in this great book, the Gita. That is important. That's why yogam uttamam, the most beautiful, the best among the yogas, is this yoga of, that is taught here. Even physical science is yoga. Yoga of physical nature. This is yoga of human nature. The depth dimension of human nature. And so we need a combination of the yoga of physical nature and the yoga of human nature. And when these two are combined, complete human happiness and welfare is bound to happen. That was a great teaching of Swami Vivekananda in the modern period. This book itself, in the last chapter, will deal with this, where you have these positivist sciences giving you control of the environment, and the science of spirituality giving you the spiritual growth of within. In that society, there will be freedom, justice, and fulfillment. That is the last testament of the Gita, the last verse, and the 18th chapter. So here in these three verses, we have a reassessment of the great philosophy expounded by Krishna in the previous two chapters, second and third. He started it in the second chapter, saying, I am now telling you a philosophy of yoga. What is that yoga? That attitude of mind by which, even though you are working all the time, dealing with human beings around you, natural forces around you, you shall not be lost. You will be able to retain your own integrity as a self. That is the philosophy he introduced in the middle of the second chapter. Buddhya yukto yaya partha karma bandham prahasyasi. You do karma, you do action. Often it makes you bound, more and more bound. But with this yoga, you will be able to see that no bondage comes though you are working all the time. What can be a greater contribution than this? We have to work, we have to live, we have to live with other people in society, but we don't want to be unfree. We want to retain our freedom, realize our true nature. Krishna says you can do with the help of this wonderful philosophy. So, he had said there, Neha Vikramanashosti Pratyavayo Navidyate Svatpamapyasya Dharmasya Trayate Mahatavabhaya. In this yoga, in this science of human possibilities, there is no waste of unfinished attempt. You can go on building up little by little, little by little. What you build up remains with you, just like character building. Whatever you build up remains with you. Then you forget. You go to something else. Come back again. Take it up. It is always with you. Thus, cumulatively, you can build up your character and your destiny. This is what he said in that verse, at the end of which he uttered beautifully, in this science, it's not a question of all or nothing. I must have the whole science or no science at all. Not at all. Svalpamapyasya dharmasya trayate mahato bhayat. Even a little of the dharma will save us from great fear. That is the nature of all science, even in physical science, agriculture. If I approach my farm with a little agricultural knowledge, I will make better harvest. A little more, still better harvest. A little more. It's not a question of the highest agriculture or no agriculture. I want even a little of science to help me to produce better, to make things better. Similarly, in spiritual life, a little of the science can help you wonderfully well. So let not anyone think, oh, I am a human being, I am limited, I am weak. What can I do with the science? This is meant for great sages? Not at all. This is meant for the weakest person, to make the person stronger and stronger. How to make the weak strong? That is the nature of science. Just like physical culture, a weak body becomes strong body by regular exercise. So in this way, our moral fiber, very weak in the beginning, we make it strong and steady, can stand any kind of external threat, tension. This kind of capacity building into human being is what the science will achieve. That is why this wonderful idea that I have taught it to you because you are my friend. And Krishna considers all humanity as his friend. He himself has said, treat me as your friend. In the last verse of the fifth chapter, Krishna will tell you this, consider me as your friend. Then you will achieve the highest. I am your friend. And therefore, from that friendship to Arjuna, he conveyed this message to him, and through him to the rest of humanity. Arjunam nimitti kritya. Arjuna is only a means, an instrument, through which the whole message will spread. Jesus spoke to 12 disciples. Later on, millions of people got the message. Buddha spoke to 5 disciples in Benares. And later on, millions of people in the whole of Asia got that message. The Gita was spoken to 1 person on the battlefield. And millions today get the benefit of it. That is the nature of this science. Beginning, slow, steady, unknown, slowly spreading, full everywhere. That is a wonderful idea of spiritual thought spreading around the world without noise, without show, without violence. Violence comes only when religion becomes caught up in political turmoils, and then all the violence and persecutions come in. But pure spirituality is absolutely free from this kind of limitation. It is only the language of peace, language of humanism, that will come out of that science of human possibility. We shall take up the other verse next Sunday when we meet here, because in the third verse there is a question, possibility of a question by Arjuna, and he is going to put that question again in the next verse, saying, how can I understand, Krishna? You taught this to sages very ancient times, and now you are teaching to me. You are my contemporary. They were both of the same age practically. Arjuna wants to know how Krishna could say, I taught it to them and I teach it to you. That formed the theme of the subject we shall study tomorrow, and Krishna's beautiful answer coming out of that question.